Hello from ABA Annual Meeting 2017 in New York City. I'm Laurence Colletti.
I'm Mark Alcott.
And we're on the road with Legal Talk Network. And we're back. We're continuing our coverage at ABA Annual here at the Hilton. And I have a guest here. His name is Mr. Mark Alcott. He's coming, actually the sessions were yesterday, but you were at the UNCLE sessions, and in particular, you were at the lunch with the President of the General Assembly as the PGA, as you told me in our little pregame before the interview, because the UN likes its acronyms. So welcome to the show, sir.
Thank you. Nice to be here.
Excellent. So before we get started, I just wanted to learn a little bit more about you. Where do you work? What do you do?
I'm a lawyer, of course. I'm at Paul Weiss, Rifkind, Wharton, and Garrison, which is two blocks from the Hilton, where the ABA is having its annual meeting. I'm a litigator, commercial disputes, business disputes, and also an arbitrator of those kinds of cases.
Excellent, excellent. So you were at the UN yesterday for all three of those sessions that were going on yesterday. And so I just wanted to kind of just get a general feel for what those were about. I know there was a lot going on, but if we could summarize it briefly, that'd be great.
Yes. Well, to begin, and just to inform your listeners, the American Bar Association has consultative status as an observer at the UN. That sometimes comes as a surprise to people, but the UN is welcoming of NGOs, non-governmental organizations, and that includes the ABA. The ABA has a long history with the UN. The ABA was active in the formation of the UN and in the concepts that found their way into the United Nations Charter. So for those reasons, we continue to be represented at the UN, and we thought it would be interesting to our members to have certain discussions that related to the work of the UN and to hold them at the headquarters of the UN, which is what we did.
Great, great. So one of those discussions was the relationship of the ABA with the UN. So there's an important partnership going on. Can we talk a little bit about that?
Well, as I said, if you go back 70 years ago or more, even before the end of World War II, the ABA promulgated a study about the future of international law in which it put forth concepts that should govern an international organization of nations. And that turned out to be the United Nations, and many of the ideas put forth by the ABA at that time found their way into the UN Charter. Ever since then, the ABA has been an active commentator on the work of the UN and an active provider of suggestions and ideas to the UN, dealing with matters of concern to the rule of law and lawyers.
Rule of law. Guys, over at the UN discussed rule of law amongst everybody in the presentations.
Yes, for sure. Well, the rule of law, which is something that we might take for granted here in the United States, is under challenge worldwide in many parts of the world. And it's an essential part of our democracy. It's an essential part of our constitutional republic, and it's an essential part of ensuring prosperity. So it is a key part of the agenda of the American Bar Association to promote the rule of law here and abroad.
Okay, so let's unpack that a little bit just for the civilians. The rule of law means what? So, you know, compared to the United States, so those countries, they're looking at our rubric of laws and our regulations and how we conduct ourselves within our country. And I would imagine that through their exchanges, they're finding things that they like about the way that we do things. And so let's explain that for the benefit of our audience.
Well, I think the basic principle is that the affairs of humanity are governed by neutral principles that apply with equal force, whether you're young or old, rich or poor, regardless of your gender or ethnicity. The same neutral principle applies. That is, in one sentence, the what the rule of law is all about. And, you know, when a case comes before a court, the court doesn't or shouldn't say, well, I like this guy, I don't like that guy, I favor this particular group, not this, so I'm going to rule in their favor. No, you have to have, and that's why justice is always depicted as wearing blindfolds. You base your decision on applying to the facts neutral principles of law.
SDGs, at the risk of dropping another acronym on the audience, SDGs, let's talk about that.
The United Nations, starting really at the beginning of the 21st century and continuing over the next 15 years, developed a series of goals known as the Sustainable Development Goals, abbreviated as the SDGs, to which all the nations of the world have subscribed as to the aspirations of global society to make this a better planet. You know, I said in my remarks, and I know we'll get to that, that the UN is an imperfect institution, but it exists in an imperfect world. And the objective of the UN is to make the world less imperfect. So we're not grandiose enough to say that we want or think we can make the world perfect, but we can make it a lot less imperfect. And these goals promulgated by the United Nations are designed to achieve that.
Okay, and so just by way of example, what are some of these goals?
Well, the goal that we as lawyers always cite is Goal 16, which is to create a more peaceful world in which there is universal access to justice for the rich as well, for the poor as well as the rich, and the rule of law governs. And there are sustainable and stable institutions that apply the law and strive for peace. That's Goal 16. It's a very ambitious goal, but it's one that all the nations of the world have now subscribed to, and we're trying to help bring it about.
Okay, so I have one last closing question for you. So your time over there at the UN, talking with people, engaging with everyone over there, is there one single takeaway that you'd like to leave with our audience today?
I would say that the most important is the tremendous interest in and support for the United Nations within the American legal community. The UN gets a bad rap often in the media, and sometimes it deserves to be criticized like any other institution. But lawyers see it as really the embodiment of the world's aspiration for a better society. And that was reflected in the tremendous turnout we had for our programs. We had to put out a sold out sign. The questions and the participation, nobody wanted to leave. So that was my takeaway.
That's fantastic. Well, thank you so much, Mark, for joining us today. And, you know, we've reached the end of this episode, but it was great talking about this. I think the UN was such a nice addition to venue for these CLE sessions by the American Bar Association. I'm sure very exciting for everybody. I wish we could have gone. Unfortunately, it didn't work out that way.
All right. Well, thank you very much for having me on your program.
All right. I want to thank our guest, Mark Alcott, for joining us today, and also our listeners for tuning in. And if you like what you heard today, please find us and rate us in Apple Podcasts. We'll see you next time for another episode of On the Road with Legal Talk Network.
If you'd like more information about what you've heard today, please visit LegalTalkNetwork.com. Subscribe via iTunes and RSS. Find us on Twitter and Facebook, or download our free Legal Talk Network app in Google Play and iTunes. The views expressed by the participants of this program are their own and do not represent the views of, nor are they endorsed by, Legal Talk Network, its officers, directors, employees, agents, representatives, shareholders, and subsidiaries. None of the content should be considered legal advice. As always, consult a lawyer.